Expectations is a Christian program that discusses a number of issues, including your health, choosing to be single and living a fulfilled life, issues of marriage and how your marriage life can have a resemblance of good traits of heaven, such as joy, peace, and love.
End time events are also not left out. The passage of homosexuality into law in America, terrorist attacks, war, corruption, disease, and hunger. There are poetry recitals.
There is only the phantom from drama who hears the drum louder. Pam, pam, serada.
Song ministrations and movies. Expectations is simply about how it all began. How is all going to end? Expectations, Jesus is on his way.
Hello out there and a very warm welcome to you. This is GTV Life, your religion and culture channel. My name is Ernest Entribuisiakon and I am here with
Felix Dazi, and I trust today we are going to have a wonderful time here on this channel as we discuss very important and pertinent issues.
Well, the program is Expectations, and Expectations, Jesus is on his way. And you know what? Today we are going to discuss two segments of the program. Mm-hmm. We have the marriage segment and then the time with Jesus segments. Felix, what do we have for us with the marriage segment?
All right. Actually, today, if people see me, they would think I'll be discussing the single segment, but I'll be sitting in for Mrs. Hadise Esther. Mm. Let me say standing in, since I'm standing already.
All right.
And we will be discussing divorce, proceeding or just forgiving. That's forgiving or proceeding to the court. And I'll be speaking to some men of God who have incredible knowledge about this, these things. So we find out what to do as Christians when we are faced with divorce.
I think it's quite such an intriguing topic because, you know, divorce has become rampant in our age at a time when, because Jesus said that love will be lost and then people will be selfish and lovers of themselves, you know. So I think it's a quite intriguing topic. And we hope that your resource persons will do justice to that topic.
Exactly. And so many Christians are in this dire situation and don't know what to do to themselves. And I think through this program, they will have a knowledge of what to do when they are hit with these things. Let me not call them disasters, but let me say these things, that's divorce.
All right. But let me kindly, you know, chip in a teaser relating to the Time with Jesus segment. We'll have the Time with Jesus segment. And the Time with Jesus segment is basically about those who have been touched by the Lord in a very special way. And before that particular section, we will talk about the fact that, you know, Felix, repentance. We'll be talking about repentance and as to whether the difference between genuine repentance and then the false repentance. And we are going to use Judas as a case study. So stick around.
All right, so stick around. I trust you'll be blessed after this program. But first of all, we are going to take a poetry recital from Gamelie, and I trust you will be blessed as a result of this. So we're taking our poetry recital, and when we come back, we're moving straight to our topic for today: divorce, forgiving, or proceeding to the court. We'll be back.
Enjoy.
On Expectations.
Once in love, in love, in love. Once in love. Now, beyond, beyond irreconcilable differences, differences, we were the most beautiful, most gorgeous, most elegant, latest couple in town, in town. The reasons for our divorce. Infidelity, cheating, the lies, the bickering, the mistrust. Once in love, in love, in love. Incompatibility, mental incompatibility, soulless incompatibility. Our visions way apart. Once in love, in love, in love, in laws interfering in our relationship, childlessness, financial constraints, lack of cash, 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 lack of cash in our marriage, lack of communication, setting us world apart, apart.
the remedy, the solution in sight. Date before marriage, seek divine guidance, direction before holy matrimony. Holy matrimony, truly once in love. In love.
Who is that girl? I'm sure not her.
Oh, no.
Welcome to Your Expectations, the marriage segment. And as I spoke earlier, I'll be sitting in for Mrs. Esther Hadisey, who can't make it here today. I'll be talking to two anointed men of God. We'll be finding out whether you should divorce, proceed to the court, or you should forgive. And I have with me here, all the way from the Upper Room Ministries International, let's welcome Apostle Hubert Aye. Welcome, sir.
Hello, man of God.
How are you doing?
I'm fine.
I love your suit.
Thank you so much.
Is it customized?
Yes, farm.
Everything for the glory of God.
Yes.
Welcome, sir.
Yes, sir.
All right, you may be seated. Okay. All right, and from the Doctor's House Ministries International, I have with me Reverend Sam Dave. All right.
Thank you, sir.
All right, you're looking great, nice too. To be with you. All right, yes. God bless you. You may be seated, sir. Yeah. You may be seated. All right, and today, House of Suits today. How you doing, sir?
Doing well.
Wow, wonderful topic today. And I hope you are going to help us digress on these issues right here on this station. Now, first of all, let me ask you, Apostle Hubert Aye. Now, how much is God hurt by so many divorce cases in our society today?
Okay, so I wouldn't say God is hurt because it's not like he doesn't know. He sees the future. So the word we'll use is he's not pleased.
He's not pleased.
Happy.
Okay.
Yes. So it's not like he's taken by surprise by what happens.
Okay.
But God is not pleased at the situation that is happening, what is happening all around, the things we hear, because that is not the intention of God. This is not the original intention of God for divorce to happen. God had to put in place a system, an institution of marriage to bring two people together.
Okay.
Because it was like a typology of what he wanted to do. So God has a picture of something he wanted to do. That is in the book of Revelation. There's a picture of God doing something. So he had to start it from the book of Genesis so we understand what he wanted to do. So marriage coming together is an intention of God to actually show us something that is going to happen, which God, he wants to do with his own people, which is he coming back to marry the bride, which is all of us who are in the body of Christ.
Wow. This leads to my next question. You are a man of God. You are a pastor of Doxa House Ministries International. You had a Bible school too. Now, let me ask you these things. You train out men of God. They are churning out from you. Let me ask you, why are there so many divorces in the church? And especially you hear men of God divorcing their wives. Why is it so many divorces in the system?
Yeah, actually it's quite disheartening when we see things like this happen, especially when the people we upcoming generation looks up to.
Mm-hmm. You hear a very great man of God and he's divorced. Why?
But the fact is, wrong is wrong no matter who is wrong. We have to establish that. Just like he said, Jesus was posed with this same question.
Mm-hmm.
They put him to test. Is it lawful for a man to put away his wife? He said, from the beginning it was not so.
Mm.
But because of the hardness of your heart,
Moses
have given you a written document so that you can do so. And he gave a new verdict over that, that it's not supposed to be so. Marriage is an institution ordained by God. It's a mystery in the sense that two people comes together to become one. Imagine when one divided into two is half, becomes an incomplete life altogether. Yeah, so it's actually something that I think the upcoming generation should look into it very well, because it is not pleasing to God. If you look at Malachi chapter 2, it says he hates it from the Living Bible.
Okay.
Other translation says he detests it. And it's actually a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God.
Mm-hmm.
When he hates something and you get it done, and you still, maybe in the name of who you think you are, now kind of justify it, instead of being humble.
Humble.
Yeah, to go back to him, to put it right. And I think the major reason is this. We live in a generation, unlike the days of my grandparents, when things get spoiled, they fix it up. Mm-hmm. But today we throw it into the trash can. We don't repair.
Like a phone getting missing, and then the person just...
And psychologically, it's affecting us.
It's affecting us.
Yeah. And there is no more patience, endurance, which is one of the fruit of the spirit, supposed to be at work in our marriages. But today you hear teachings like marriage to be enjoyed and not to be endured. That's a fallacy.
That's a fallacy.
Yes, because endurance is part of marriage. Most of the marriages does not break because of the very act of the problem. It breaks because the couple will come up, I can't take it anymore.
So let me ask you, if you hear a man of God who has divorced his or her wife, is he still a man of God?
He's still a man of God. That cannot make him not to be a man of God.
Does his anointing reduce?
The anointing will not reduce because his calling is without repentance. The gift is without repentance. So he can still do so much like Samson.
Okay.
But somehow it's possible he's been abandoned by God. Because you can work for God and be abandoned, but you cannot walk with God and be abandoned.
You know, wives are very important in ministry. Imagine, I'm not saying it should happen. Imagine your wife is mishandling you at home.
Yep.
You are going through a lot at home. You don't even have the peace of mind to concentrate. Would you divorce her?
I will not, because Jesus.
You will still endure that.
Yeah, Jesus.
Your members come to your house and she starts throwing tantrums at them. Yeah.
That's, you see, you have to look at the teachings of Jesus. He says, if any man will follow me,
but Jesus Christ never married.
He never, but he told us what to do.
Okay,
and he knows we have the ability to do it. He said, if any man wants to follow me, deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. Today's Christianity, we don't want to deny ourselves. Self is the major reason. Self is the major reason. If my wife becomes my cross, I will carry her and follow Jesus.
That's my solution. All right. So let me ask you, why are there so many men of God who are facing divorce? I'm looking at the why now.
Okay.
And
okay.
So many, we get to see so many divorces in church. Why?
Okay, so let me take it from the Jacob experience. Before the man of God, there is a man first. So we are with Elijah is a man that is subject to like passions.
That's right.
So you have an emotional state of your being the man of God. So every man of God has a kind of expectation he wants from a wife.
That's right.
Okay. Now when you lose that expectation and you marry the wrong person, you have a problem in your marriage.
Okay.
So Jacob sees Rachel, and this is the person he wants to marry. Then later on, he's introduced to Leah.
Yeah.
So in the morning when he wakes up, this is the wrong person. Remember, he's a man. He has the ability to be attracted.
Right.
You see, so you are a man. That emotional part of you is there. That attraction side of you is there. Because every man of God, it's not about the anointing. You see, you have a place. You have a spirit. You live in a body.
Yeah.
Now, if you ignore this side, because when you want to give birth, you don't give birth by anointing. It's not anointed that gives birth. You see, so there's a physical side of you.
Mm-hmm.
When we ignore that side and we use certain reasons to get married, then when you get into the marriage, you develop problems. Issues are going to come up. And when the issues come up, then the marriage cannot stand.
Mm-hmm.
Then you begin to regret, why did I do this? Why did I do this? And like the man of God said, we get to a point where we don't want to endure. We don't want to endure. And the second thing is that it is when you say, okay, I preach what I know, but I don't learn from what I preach from. So a man of God will preach, but he doesn't do what he says he's preaching. Because if you tell people they are supposed to endure, what about you? You're also supposed to endure and go through it and accept responsibility that the foundation of the marriage in the first place was not right. You didn't do it right. So now, half time, there are people who help out. There are other men of God who come together. They'll pray with you. And then you solve the issue. But the main problem is because our emotional side gets over the spiritual side.
Mm.
Where you are attracted to somebody and you feel this is the one.
So you forget to hear from God. You mean one of the reasons is wrong choice.
Wrong right? choices. Wrong choices.
Right.
And the fact that we don't go by what the word of God says.
But talking about these wrong choices, can't you say, oh, I'm taking this one, I see these flaws in her, but I think I can work out something just as I've been working out of my members. I work out?
So the thing is that before you get a partner, God has to put two people who are different together. You
have to negative and positive.
A negative and positive in order for it to work. And we are looking for a perfect woman. We are looking for a perfect man. There's no perfect woman. There's no perfect man. It's only a perfect God that we have. So by the time you want to marry somebody who the Bible said that she is suitable, she's a help to you. So we look for the type of a woman that is from your rib. Because the woman was taken out of the rib of a man. So you look for the rib of yours and you connect. And even in her imperfections, there's a way you love her imperfections. Right. I remember a woman came to me and then she says that I love my man despite everything that's happening. And I said, what do you love? He said, the man has a big tummy and that's what I love.
Why
people are looking for six packs? Like I said, that's what I love. Like so mine. She's going beyond the imperfections. Right. You see, so that's what we need to do. Wow. Find your suit mate, the one that God has designed for you.
Okay.
And even when there's mistakes, you can work it out.
But there are men of God who break up. Now, why are these... Let me find out the examples of these men of God. How would it impact on church members and unbelievers if themselves were to fall victims of divorce?
Okay,
maybe a man of God divorces.
Exactly.
How would it have an impact on the church?
Great impact. This is a leader of a church.
That's right.
These are people are putting their confidence in you. You preach, they listen. You give instructions, they are by. You are more or less a representative of God to them.
Some of you think you are the assistant of God.
You are the assistant of God, okay? And they are following. I mean, there are people who are copying the way you dress. Mm-hmm. They are copying the way you talk.
That's right.
They want to preach like you. They want to be like you. So by the time you divorce, you have set another door open for them to follow.
Right.
And they are going to have a cause to be justified and say, because this man of God did it, I can also do it.
Mm.
So we need to look at it very well because it's having a damaging impact on the people that are coming. And for young people like us who are coming, some of these things, it scares us.
Yeah.
Because by the time you see an elephant fall, and you are a grass cutter, you should be careful. So you will need the grace of God
to really stand
and see such things happening and say, you know what, I will not copy this, but I'll pray. Mm-hmm. Because the other side of it is that you actually don't know what happened.
That's right.
You don't know.
You actually don't know what happened over there before the man of God divorced.
That's
you know, so the most important thing is that don't judge too much, but you pray from where you are and look at it as, look, this has happened, but I'm not copying it. I'm not going that direction. Because the word of God doesn't go in that direction.
Now, who advises the pastor when he's facing all these things? Okay, we'll look at that later on. But what about unbelievers? Wouldn't they say, look at these men of God, divorce everywhere. You want me to give my life to Christ. Now, I'm seeing you do the things that Jesus Christ said we shouldn't do. Now, how does these divorces of men of God and Christians have an impact on unbelievers?
Yeah, that's the painful part of it. Because unbelievers don't read their Bibles. Readers. We are supposed to be living epistles.
Mm. So they look at you and say, I'm following.
Yes. Exactly. So when we begin to go in the direction that is natural for them to go, then there will not be any difference.
Mm.
So I think we should live up to expectations so that our lifestyle will affect them positively for God. That's what I think.
Wow. Mm. So does it have an impact on unbelievers? Do you have
obviously,
do you have an example?
Obviously, I've had encounter because we go out to preach, we meet people, and one of the things they'll tell you is that if this pastor is doing this, if this man of God is doing this, what about us who want to be born again? Why should we follow you? You know, so it's really damaging. Unbelievers, it's the saddest thing you can ever hear, because it's heartbreaking for some of us that have a burden for the church. We want to win souls, we want to go out there and get people into the church, and this is one of the major hindrances that you go out there and you are faced with this question. You know, and you have to go all around and bring so much examples for them to get before they will be able to even listen to you and talk to you. So it's really damaging.
Right.
And we need to come together, really do something about this. Because if we don't, the kind of image that Christianity is creating right now, it will really destroy a lot of good that is happening.
Okay, now let me ask you, as believers, will we be held accountable solely by our actions? And how important is it that we don't cite the cases of some men of God to justify our own situation and thus proceed to divorce?
You know, man of God, first of all, even those who are married, the Bible said that one will be on the bed, one will be taken. So everyone is responsible for their actions.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So by the time you are saying that because a man of God did this, so I can do it, you are actually misled. You are, because you stand before God alone. You will not be there with anybody. And I've never seen anywhere in the Bible where it says that you and your wife will even stand on judgment day to be judged. So by the time even marriage, two people are not going to be judged. You who you are outside there and you are looking at it should not look at it and say, this is an example for me to divorce. Because your actions, God is going to judge your thought. Yeah. He's going to judge your intentions. He's going to judge your motives. Everything you do is going to come under judgment. So it is a personal thing. Salvation is a personal thing. They say, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Wow. So when you're looking at these things, it's time to pray. It's time to get back to the altar and pray. Mm-hmm. But for you, you have to make sure that you don't follow. The last thing is that when you see somebody moving and the person falls, okay, it's a good example for you to go the other way.
That's right.
So the example of somebody who's having a divorce is actually beneficial to you. Now you know that, hey, the enemy is at work here. So let me go in the other direction. Right, so you don't just go and say, you fall in the pit. Mm. Once you fall in the pit, then you are even worse than the person who went into it. Mm. Yeah.
Wow. Now, let me ask you, Reverend Sam Davis, yes, what is so bad about divorce? And we are asking this question based on Malachi chapter 2, verse 15 to 16, where God says he detests divorce. What is so bad about divorce?
Yeah, what's so bad is this. Marriage is actually not just an ordinary relationship. It's a covenant. It's a covenant. A covenant between two persons. Mm-hmm. And God is involved. Mm-hmm. And it is the heartbeat of God. Mm-hmm. It is the heartbeat of mm-hmm. God. He intended a man and a woman to be together until death do them part.
No matter what.
No matter what.
Exactly.
So when there is a divorce case, mm-hmm. it goes a long way to even affect the society at large. Mm. Your productivity becomes reduced mm-hmm. in the place of work. You cannot concentrate. I had an uncle who was a pilot. He went through issues like that. And at the end of the day, he could not be at his peak anymore until he died. Mm-hmm. So it's quite devastating. It's quite devastating. I'm a product of a divorced home. My father left my mom while I was less than one. And when I tried to find out, they told me just because my dad was a military man, my mom wanted to go learn nursing, and for my dad, nursing is for prostitutes. And that was just the mere issue. And I know what I went through, you understand, to grow up to become who I am today by the grace of God, in the hands of a stepmother. Wow. Naturally, the children will feel the effect. Mm-hmm. Not to even talk about the psychological
problems. Let's talk about the repercussions. What are some of the repercussions in your own words?
Yeah, in my own words, it's not healthy mm-hmm. for the people involved. Mm-hmm. It's looking like the Bible says the man is the head of the wife, while the wife is the body. So if you leave your wife, you are like a head just walking on the street. You are more like a ghost. And if you leave your husband, you're like a body just walking without a head. So imagine a body without a head. Somehow it's quite so I think when you weigh it in the line of the word of God, since God hates it, I think it has a serious implication.
God says he detests it. That means he hates it.
He hates it. That's the meaning of the word. In the Living Translation, Living Bible, say he hates it. Mm-hmm. And what God hates, if you are involved in it, I don't think there's a special anointing to use to cover up. I don't think so.
Because the man himself hates it.
Yeah, I don't think
Prophet Hubert, let me ask you. You are a prophet and you are a pastor of your church too. Mm. You get a lot of people coming with you with divorce issues, right?
So many of it.
Okay, now what are some of the repercussions that you get to see as a result of divorces?
First of all, the word divorce itself in the original Hebrew translation means a cutting.
A cutting.
It means two souls that have been joined together and they are not just being separated.
That's right.
There's a cutting process. Mm. It's like you've taken a knife and you are really cutting. Mm. Now, the other thing is that divorce is a death of a relationship, but it's not the death of life.
That's right.
So what you do is that even though you have ended the relationship, you have not ended. You are still alive mm-hmm. and it's continuing. Mm. And you have just cut your soul from the person. Okay? And what happens is that you have damaged covenant.
Mm.
The man of God is talking about covenant. Covenant is the most important thing to God. The reason is that there is going to be a marriage covenant.
That's right.
When Jesus comes back, he's going to marry his church. Mm. And that covenant is going to be forever. So he has to put a picture for us to see it. And the picture is the marriage picture. So we are coming together to become one and to be there forever. Now you take a knife and you cut this thing out. there's bleeding.
That's right.
So your heart is going to bleed. Yes. Everything about you is going to bleed. The second thing God talked when he said, I detest marriage, is when he said that it will not produce godly children.
That's right.
There will not be, and the children you raise up, they will not be, they will not get the right care, the right family care, that's instructions. Right. You know, so like the man of God, he says, he's a product of a divorced family. I'm the same. Yeah. You see, and you see a lot of people who are into all kinds of vices,
that's right,
all kinds of problems, armed robbery, all those things. It even affects the economy. Because once family is a thing of God,
yeah.
God loves a family. When a family is divided, you are even dividing your nation because there's no togetherness. Those children are going to rise up and they are going to cause problem for the nation. So there's going to be financial loss. There's going to be headaches, heart attacks. You are going to get sicknesses and disease all over your body.
Improper training.
Because of what is happening.
That's right.
So psychologically, you are being affected. Emotionally, you are being affected. Financially, you are being affected. So the problems is vast. It's not something you want to endure.
You want to endure.
Because once you divorce somebody, it's not like the person will just go. You see the person again.
That's right.
And when you see the person, the pain will come back again. The head to come back again.
And sometimes they tend to stretch the pain on the children.
Exactly. And that is where the children now go wayward. Because once a child is with their mother and there's no father, there's no head in the house, right, they can do anything they want.
Wow.
So imagine a child in school and there's no control. So he goes and joins the gang, the peer pressure is there, and then he goes on and then becomes an armed robber, becomes something else, you know. And these are the things that are happening, and even more than that.
So as Christians, if you are faced with the issue of divorce, do you get to proceed to the court or you have to solve it as Christians?
Okay, so this is the answer I give. Anytime somebody asks me this is what I say. I say, you were at the wedding day. You made invitations.
That's right.
You invited a whole lot of people to come so that they watch you come together. The pastor was there. You did food and everything. If you want to divorce, call the people back. And let the pastor come back. Cook food. And say, this is not
like
where...
Jollof.
Cook jollof.
Same.
The same thing. And say,
wear the gown again.
The white
gown. The suit again. Yeah. And come and say, we want to divorce. But you don't come to church where you come and make vows to God. Then you run to the court for a man to put you asunder.
Right.
The Bible says, let no man put asunder.
What God has joined
together. And what we don't know is that there are a lot of people who are walking, they think they are divorced, but in heaven,
They are still married.
Yeah. So anywhere they go, they commit adultery.
That's right.
Anybody who comes to marry you, you commit adultery with the person.
That's what Jesus said.
Yeah, wow. Exactly. Yeah.
So what advice would you give to a member? That member is facing, he's married to someone who abuses him, okay, abuses her. Normally, yeah, it's the females who face that, abuses her. She's going through hell. She's being tormented and she wants to divorce. She wants to go to the court. Yeah. What would be your advice for the person?
Yeah, I think... I've faced a very practical situation like that, and I don't think I would be happy to see a man bullying my member every now and then. So in as much as we don't advise proceed to court, we can advise a temporary separation.
A temporary separation?
Yeah.
Is that not divorce?
It's not.
Is that not divorce?
It's not in the sense that perhaps it might be a withdrawal to put things right.
Okay.
Yeah. And while you're away, there will be every reason to be able to calm down, think well, to see where the issue is. And by intervention, I believe the church leadership can come in, the presbytery, and it can be sorted out through forgiveness.
Mm-hmm. That's to forgive. Yeah.
And listen to me, man of God. I've heard a case where a wife committed adultery, and the man heard it, and the man called the wife, honey, I know something must have led to this. Can you just tell me what happened? And she broke down, explained, and said, don't worry, let's go ahead.
The marriage That's a strong man.
And listen to another scenario. A man divorced his wife for the basis of where the lady presses the toothpaste from. he liked pressing from under, very tight man.
Maybe he's managing
lady,
the economy.
Thank you. And here's a lady who just hold the middle. Like myself, my children, they can press anywhere they like. Instead of just daring with that, because of toothpaste, I can't take it anymore. And you see, the truth is the fruit of the spirit is what should be operational in the marriage. If it is there, I think you can forbear one another in love. You can forbear one another.
So going to the court is wrong.
It's totally wrong because that's the last option. Right in the court, there is no justice there. Let's be real with ourselves.
Wow.
The Bible says, why will you have issues and you don't sort it out within yourselves?
Yeah.
you go to unjust judges.
So the judge,
that's how they are called. Yeah.
Now you spoke.
So
about,
the court should be the last option.
Okay.
If the church is not, and I don't even advise to go there.
The court. Yeah, wow. Now you spoke about adultery. Mm-hmm. Perfect. Now let me ask you. Apart from adultery, what can lead to separation?
Among
Christians, actually.
Among Christians, yeah. There are only two things that the Bible states that can lead to the separation,
yeah,
which is
two things.
The first one is fornication or adultery.
That's right.
Then the second one is the death of a partner.
That's right.
And that one, it's way out there. Now, in addition to what the man of God said, we have to understand that this whole marriage thing, it's something that is on the heart of God.
That's right.
It's on the heart of God. You don't do what you like. You do what the Bible says. The Bible is your guide.
That's right.
So you are being abused, okay? Now, there is a cost to everything. Mm. Everything has a cost. Mm. There's no man who gets up and just abuses. It must have started from a place. So if he needs counseling, he has to go for the counseling and sort out. Maybe he was abused when he was a child.
Yeah.
And he doesn't know it. And psychologically, it's coming up. Now, there is only one rule to marriage for it to work. It's simple. Ephesians 5:22.
That's right.
It says a woman, humble yourself. The man should love.
Wow.
It's done.
So women are not supposed to be talking plenty.
When you talk back, when you
be laughing plenty. Yours is submission.
Submission. And that's the key. And that's what a lot of people don't know.
A lot of women don't know.
It's the word of God. It's the word of God. And God's word is ultimate.
That's right.
I mean, God is wiser than everybody. And he puts it there. He said, if a woman is submissive, every man, it doesn't matter the situation that is at home. Maybe the wife did something, okay? The only thing that comes out of his mouth is, my wife doesn't respect me. He doesn't say anything else. The only thing a man says, my wife doesn't respect me. The only thing a woman says, my husband doesn't love me anymore. Mm. He doesn't care.
Because he has to see someone else.
Exactly. So imagine if that the missing link is being provided,
yeah,
which is that there's humility. Every man wants a humble woman.
That's right.
Every man.
It's in our DNA. Exactly. We're born with it.
Exactly.
To have a woman who's very submissive.
Because nobody wants to have a second mother.
No, because no, it's actually true. We are babies. Mm-hmm. Men are actually babies. Mm-hmm. We want to be pampered.
Mm.
We love it. But we try to be all egoistic and move. But every man loves the pampering. So that's where God says, okay, be submissive to the man. So when a man sees the submission, he loves.
Natural.
You pull it out. There was there's a part there where Apostle Paul said that a believing woman can win an unbelieving man by her words and her actions. Her words and actions can win an unbelieving man. So there is something about a woman when she's submissive and she knows how to talk her way out. Listen. You win the man forever.
But we know our Father is in heaven is a forgiving God. Yeah. Let me ask this question. At the same time, as a just God as well, who will punish our disobedience to his command? So how can we have this assurance of reconciliation if we have genuinely repented after divorce? Maybe someone has faced divorce, the person is watching it. How can the person receive forgiveness? Or can he be genuinely forgiven if he's gone through this already?
Yeah, it has to do with the faith of the believer. Because Christianity actually is a project of faith. Having confidence in God, in his word, that if he says, when we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Your faith should be in that word.
Okay.
And as long as your faith is in that word, God will give you the ability to believe that you have been forgiven.
Forgiven. So yeah. Forgiveness is possible.
Very possible.
Yes. Forgiving. Yeah. I mean, that's the ultimate. Yeah. You have to forgive yourself.
That's right.
You have to forgive the
even
the
if you've divorced already.
Yes.
And you know biblically that you are in heaven, you are attached on something.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You can be forgiven.
There is true sincerity. There's a place where you get to where God knows you really mean what you are saying.
Yeah.
And that's where faith comes in. I mean, I've seen where God said, look at Ahab, how Ahab has humbled himself.
Mm-hmm.
And because of that, the judgment that God was going to put on Ahab, he just said, I'm not going to put that judgment anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So when we come before, remember the blood of Jesus is available for the forgiveness of sins. Mm-hmm. So when we come to God in true repentance, and we pour out our heart there, remember, it doesn't stop there. That doesn't stop there. If you hurt the person, you have to follow up.
That's right.
and go seek the forgiveness like of the person.
President's case.
Like the President's case.
You buy three bags.
You buy three and there's a wrapper as a birthday gift.
And it solves the problem.
And it solves the problem.
It solves the problem. Yeah. Wow. Yeah. Wow. Yeah. Let me ask you, how careful must we be so that we don't abuse God's forgiveness? Let me start with you, sir.
Yeah. Paul actually made this rendering in the book of Romans. He says, shall we continue to sin so that grace may abound?
Okay.
He said, God forbid.
Okay.
Grace is not a license to commit sin.
Grace is not a license.
It's just like it's been stretched today in the messages we hear. But then grace gives you the ability to say no to sin. It empowers you. So in as much as we live in a very sinful world, there are ups and downs that comes your way. But knowing fully well that the grace of God is there for you, it will help you to say no to sin, to deny ungodliness.
Okay.
Yeah. So I believe we don't take advantage of the fact that grace is available.
Okay. And we don't continue abuse to God's forgiveness.
Sin. Yeah, that abuse.
Okay, so let me ask you, how careful must one be not to abuse God's forgiveness? Since we also know he's a just God and he will punish those who walk in disobedience.
Okay, so before Jesus ever talked about the marriage issue, that's in Matthew 19. Mm. Matthew 18, he started talking about forgiveness.
That's right.
Started talking, and he made a scenario of a gentleman who had taking money from a king, and the king was like, you have to pay back. And then he begged and he said, okay, I leave you alone. He leaves the palace and then he finds somebody who owes him and then goes after the person, takes the family and lock them up. You know, when the king heard it, the king was like, you were forgiving. Why were you not? Why were you not even in the position to forgive somebody? Right. So the thing is this, to him, to whom much is forgiven, much is required.
Yeah.
So you were forgiven by grace at birth. When you had given your life to Jesus, Jesus forgave you of all your sins and blotted out all your iniquities, okay? Mm-hmm. Why would you not forgive somebody else when the person offends you and you want to abuse it? You see, so you look at what God has done for you, what Jesus has done for you on the cross of Calvary, and then you look at that and you share forgiveness, but not abuse it.
Wow, thank you so much, man of God. All right, this is where time will allow us. But don't forget, on the marriage segment of expectations, next time we will look at the number of ways one can prevent divorce and also saving the Christian marriage. But now, Ernest stands by to bring us the time where Jesus segment. Trust you have enjoyed this segment. I'll be talking to Prophet Hubert Aye from the Upper Room Ministries International and also from the Doxa House Ministry. I've been talking to Reverend Sam Day. So let's welcome NX. We move on to the next segment as NX takes us through with the time with Jesus. Please stay with us on Expectation.
Wishes could be easy. Why is life so messy? Why is pain a part of us? There were days to feel like nothing ever goes right. Sometimes it just hurts so bad, but you're here and you're real. I know I can trust you, even when it hurts, even when it's hard, even when it all just falls apart. I will trust in you, 'cause I know that you right inside upon you each and every moment. What's gone and what is broken happened just the way you planned. But you're here and you're real. I know I can trust in you.
Even when it hurts, even when it hurts, even when it all just falls apart,
I will trust in you, 'cause I know that you are the lover of my soul, healer of my scars. You're steady my heart, tears in your eyes. I will sing to you, cause of everything you are. You stand in my hand, oh, you stand in my hand.
Expectations is a Christian program that discusses a number of issues, including your health, choosing to be single and living a fulfilled life, issues of marriage and how your marriage life can have a resemblance of good traits of heaven, such as joy, peace, and love.
End time events are also not left out. The passage of homosexuality into law in America, terrorist attacks, war, corruption, disease, and hunger. There are poetry recitals.
There is only the phantom from drama who hears the drum louder. Pam, pam, serada.
Song ministrations and movies. Expectations is simply about how it all began. How is all going to end? Expectations, Jesus is on his way.
Hello and welcome back to the program. It is Expectations on GTV Life, your religion and culture channel. Expectations, Jesus is on his way. And you know what, Felix just discussed divorce and as to whether Christians are to proceed to the courts or are to forgive their spouse when they wrong them. Well, I think they did justice to that, you know, topic, and we hope that viewers out there have picked, you know, pieces of information to guide their decisions, their daily decisions, which are very crucial to their internal life. So we'll quickly move on, you know, with the program, and have been joined by Prophet Gideon Akoto Tamaklu. He is the CEO of the Peculiar Treasuries Ministries at Community 22 Annex, and also Stephen Tufour. He's at the House of Jesus for All Nations at Ogbojo in Accra, right?
Yeah.
All right. You're welcome, gentlemen, to the studios of GTV Live.
Thank you.
All right. So quickly, let me start with Prophet here. Prophet, can you tell us, you know, in a catchy way, how you were called into ministry and how you were touched by the Lord in a very unique, special way?
I was a DJ, and by then I was with a group called Mystic Sound, and then they live at Canto Mentier. So we decide to go on a trip, a trek to Elibo. So our coming back, we passed through Akutia just to play a spinning over there. And then the Lord touched my heart that I should stop what I was doing. So I just decided, at that moment, I just decided to tell them that I cannot go with them again. So I returned home.
Okay.
And then when I got home, that very day, there was a crusade. Mm. So I just went direct to the crusade. And then I surrounded myself to Christ.
Okay, I'll come back to you, but let me quickly go to Mr. Stephen Tufour. Mr. Stephen, what can you tell us in brief how you were also, you know, called into ministry, but also try to expatiate on the fact that what kind of specific ministry were you called into?
Oh, okay. With me, I was born a sickler.
Okay.
And due to the sickness, I lost my mom when I was around 7. And you know, as a sick person, it was just seeking help from physicians, from name it, witch doctors, traveling from here, traveling from there. I quite remember when I was around 5, I traveled with an auntie of mine to one of a very powerful, herbalist in Ghana. And when you go there, you buy a fowl and you spit in the mouth of the fowl. Then as the herbalist is working, they will just tear the head of the fowl. Then he will begin to prophesy, and he will begin to talk about where the sickness is coming from and who gave you the sickness. And when the man got hold of my fowl, he just came back to himself. He asked my auntie, whose fowl is this? And they said, it belongs to this young boy. He said, take him out from here. He is a man of God.
My God. Wow. So you are saying that the native doctor supposedly, he saw it in the wild.
He asked my auntie, take this boy out from here. He is a man of God.
My God.
So it was just sickness. The enemy just wanted to give me something like epilepsy. And I always say, people with epilepsy are embedded with great destiny. So immediately the enemy sees God has something for you, he will put that sickness on you, which will prevent you from coming in front of people. You know that ministry, you face people, you meet people. So when you are having epilepsy, you shy away from people. You are just at the back, you know, you are just there. And through that, I received the grace of God. The power of God was upon my life. Wow. And
how many years is this?
About 27 years now.
Wow.
So I have not been into any profession. Mm-hmm. My profession has been ministry. Yeah.
So what would you say in brief is the specific ministry that you've been called into?
I am a worshiper.
All right. Okay, let me come to Prophet Gideon. So what can you also tell us in brief the specific ministry you've been called into by the Lord in a very special way? How you're touched by the Lord in a very special way?
I've been called into a prophetic ministry.
Okay.
And how it happens, I may say, where I was coming from, my spiritual father used to invite prophets into the ministry for programs. Mm. So that made them to prophesy upon my life. So when they more than 20 prophets who came into our ministry, they always prophesy about my life, that the Lord will use me when comes into the prophetic ministry. So I was not other convinced. So later on I just come into myself and I said, no, something has been said into my life, so I have to work on it. So I traveled to Atria. By then, now we used to go to Atria. People used to go to Atria to preach and to pray over there. So I traveled there and I went and then seek for the face of the Lord for 40 days. Wow. And my coming down, everything just changed.
It's changed. Yeah. Wow. That's an interesting story. But what would you say? Because, you know, there are a lot of doubters out there for those who may not even believe in God, called atheist, and for those who, you know, somehow they just don't believe that there was somebody who lived 2,000 years ago, you know, named Jesus and lived with us as, you know, as God incarnate in the flesh, right? So my question to you, both of you, it's that what would you say to such a person who's a doubter, right? The strongest, what would you say is your strongest evidence of God in your life? The strongest evidence, because there are a lot of evidences that probably you may, you know, resort to. But what would you say is your strongest evidence of the existence of God in your life? Okay, let me start with that.
With me, I have so many strongest evidence.
Okay.
Because with someone who was sick, standing at National Theater and you just get confused. You understand? I was standing at National Theater and we were supposed to sing at an audition. And immediately they called me to sing. I was off.
Wow.
You understand? I was just off. And at our basic education, I was just off.
Okay.
And at our basic education time, anytime we write exams, the sickness comes. Wow. So I wasn't promoted with examination. I was promoted based on classes,
okay.
You know, the merits in class. Mm-hmm. Now, when we were going to write a basic education certificate, this auntie who didn't know Christ held my hand. He said, God, this boy, you know how he loves you. Mm-hmm. BEC, if he does not pass, he is not going to continue to the secondary school. Mm-hmm. If he comes out, within the 5 days without any hitch of the problem or the sickness, mm-hmm. I am going to give my life to you. And within the 5 days, the sickness did not show up.
Wow.
I passed,
wow.
Got my first choice, and from there, I have never seen the sickness again.
Wow. You never had crisis since then again?
No.
My God. Wow, this I think is such a touching, unique story. Well, let me also come to Prophet Gideon. What would you say is your strongest evidence of the existence of God in your life?
Yeah, I will say, you know, a lot of things has happened, but yes, the Lord is God.
Mm.
If only you know Him.
Yes.
And you know that He is with you. Mm. Nothing will turn up your mind. You okay. Continue to follow Him. I've passed through a lot of things, mm-hmm. whereby sometimes, if I'm saying something, I don't know where to start from,
okay.
and then where to end.
Okay.
There are a lot of things that I've went through,
a lot has delivered
and
you.
Then the Lord has mm-hmm. delivered, because you know, every area with the Spirit
mm-hmm.
that rules there.
Mm-hmm.
So just look that you are in an area which I may say. Even sorry to say that these Ashawu women,
mm-hmm.
They are at that area.
Okay.
And then people who drunks and so forth, you are in the midst of them.
Mm-hmm.
And then they are doing all sorts of things. Whereby wherever they are going, they want you to follow them. Even when I was a man of God, when I became a man of God, something happened. A friend of mine called me. By then, he was a Muslim.
Okay.
And then when he called me, he told me that you said, I've become a man of God. I've given you 2 weeks. And I know that you return from the God that you said you have seen
him. And how long has it been since he said that?
Since he said that, almost 16 to 18 years now.
Wow. And your faith
and my faith now, my faith
keeps growing.
Yes.
Wow. So I'll take your final words on the time with Jesus. You know, so what would you say to viewers out there? Your final words to viewers out there, so that they too, because of your experiences, they too would have an experience with the Lord in a very special, unique way. So,
you know, any time
the final words, yeah,
you fall, you have to try to rise again, because in life, if you know the God that you serve, you will not allow anything even to draw you back. Because the scripture said in John chapter 3, verse number 17, that God did not send His Son to condemn the world, but rather through Him we might be saved.
Yeah.
So they shouldn't allow anything to put them down.
Okay.
Or they shouldn't allow the fear to put them down.
All right. All right. To be downhearted. Yeah. Right. So your final words, sir.
I want to tell viewers out there that it is good to be in any religion, but any religion that does not profess Jesus as the way, the truth, and the life is a false religion.
Okay, that's
that is my
one.
Final word.
That's your final word. All right, so I have been here with Prophet Gideon Akoto, who is just at my immediate right. Prophet Gideon Akoto is the head pastor of Peculiar Treasuries Ministries at the Community 22 Annex, and also at my extreme right, he says that Jesus, without Jesus being the way, then that religion is a false one. Religion. And his name is Stephen Tufor, and he's the head pastor, right? Head pastor of House of Jesus for All Nations. But you know, viewers, my strongest evidence of the fact that there is an existence of God is that, you know, well, we have the Bible, we have the Holy Spirit and all of that. Those are physical. Let me say, the Holy Spirit is spiritual, but then the Bible is a more physical evidence of the existence of God. But for me, the strongest evidence will be, you know, from the first line of Genesis, which says that in the beginning, God created the world or the earth. So on that note, we'll be right back.
Expectations is a Christian program that discusses a number of issues, including your health, choosing to be single and living a fulfilled life, issues of marriage and how your marriage life can have a resemblance of good traits of heaven, such as joy, peace, and love.
End time events are also not left out. the passage of homosexuality into law in America, terrorist attacks, war, corruption, disease, and hunger. There are poetry recitals.
There is only the phantom from drama who hears the drum louder. Pam, pam, serada.
Song ministrations and movies. Expectations is simply about how it all began. How is all going to end? Expectations, Jesus is on his way.
Hello and welcome back from that break. The program is still Expectations on GTV Life, your religion and culture channel. Expectations, Jesus is on his way. We are seeing that Jesus is coming, whether you like it or not, whether you believe it or not. We are saying that Expectations, Jesus is on his way. And we are on the very final part of the Time with Jesus segment on this program. So I have been joined by Mr. Ose Kweku. He is the Director of Works at the Valley View University here in Accra. Mr. Ose, you're welcome to the studios of GTV Life.
Thank you very much.
Nice. All right, today we'll be talking about true repentance as against false repentance, because sometimes we know some repentance may be born out of guilty conscience. So we want to actually know the difference between true, genuine repentance as against, you know, false repentance. I think that Judas is a case study of false repentance as against, you know, David's true repentance, when in Psalm 51, he had a very elaborative, you know, psalm on repentance. So, Mr. Osei, quickly, kindly tell us, my first question to you is, what was it about Jesus' teaching about the kingdom of heaven that caused Judas to reject it?
Thank you very much. You realize when you read John chapter 8 verse 23 and again John chapter 18:36, Jesus talks about the fact that his kingdom is not of this world. Elsewhere he says, I come from above, I am from above, you are from beneath. And that didn't sit too well with Judas. Okay. You may realize that elsewhere Jesus had, one disciple had come and he wanted to follow Jesus. The scholars think that that was Judas. And Jesus tells him, foxes have holes, birds have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. Okay. And that was more or less a warning for him to look inward, to look at what is your motive for coming to follow me. You can see that at the end of the day, when he realized that Jesus' kingdom was not an earthly one, because maybe he had expected to be a minister or whatever in that. And among the disciples, he realized he kept the bag. So you could say, if a kingdom was going to come, maybe he was going to hold the finance minister's position. Okay. Unfortunately, the Bible tells us, even John, that he was a chief. And he was helping himself to what little resources came to the disciples and to Jesus. So eventually when he realized that, like the normal Jews at that time were looking forward to the Messiah, who was, they're actually attributing the second coming of Jesus to his first coming. You know, in second coming, we are looking at him coming as a king, king of kings to judge. But in the first, he came as a lamb, as it were, a lamb led to the slaughter, our redeemer. But unfortunately, the Jews had
misconstrued the whole event.
They exchanged the whole thing. They were attributing the coming in power, the coming in glory to the first coming. And that was what Jesus was. In fact, most of the disciples, remember at one time they said, will you at this time, even after the resurrection, they still weren't convinced, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? So they were still looking forward to that physical kingdom. And that was what Judas was looking forward to. And when Jesus said, my kingdom is not like that, he was a little devastated. So no wonder, I think, then let me make haste and take whatever little I can take. So he sold his master for 30 pieces of silver.
Well, he sold his master for 30 pieces of silver. But then, Mr. Osei, can you briefly, concisely tell us what true repentance is and then false repentance, using Judas as a case study and then perhaps David as well?
Okay, thank you very much. Repentance, when you look at a dictionary, they will tell you simply as remorse for something that you've done. Okay. But it actually goes beyond remorse. Remorse for what? Over whom? True repentance are not look at exactly what or what is involved. Usually, it's like, let's take a case where a kid has done something wrong and you take a cane or something, you're going, the person says, I'm sorry, what are you sorry about? Most of the time, with repentance, that's a attribute of false repentance. People repent or they are remorseful because of the consequences that they expect to follow. So they are remorseful about the beating that is coming to him.
The punishment.
Not the punishment.
Mm.
Not what he has done, as it were. So you see it all over. Esau.
Yeah.
Esau, when he had sold his birthright to the brother, mm-hmm. he realized that he was remorseful, was begging the father to bless him again. Mm-hmm. It wasn't for, he did not have respect to the birthright, mm-hmm. but what he had lost, the consequence was what he was looking at. Again, Balaam, when he was going to curse Israel, mm-hmm. he also said he was sorry. Sorry for what? Just because he saw the angel with the sword drawn,
mm-hmm.
that was it. Pharaoh, so many times you say, I've sinned. Pray to the Lord for me. Why? So that you escape the punishment.
Exactly.
So that is an aspect or an attribute of one characteristic of false repentance.
Mm.
People are remorseful, in quote, not for the action, but for the consequence. And we see that especially with Judas.
So then can we then say that with Judas, because of the magnitude or perhaps the grievous nature of what he did, which he said that, which even Jesus said that it would have been better if he had not been born, right?
Yes.
So would you then say that that was perhaps why he took his own life?
Very, very, very true. Because here we see him in the judgment hall throwing the 30 silver pieces at the feet of the descendant, saying that, confessing to everybody that he has sinned.
Mm.
If it were genuine, he wouldn't have gone to hang himself.
Okay.
He was seized with this fearful looking forward of judgment.
Mm.
Like, he's done something so terrible.
Yeah.
Because it's like, was torn in between. Is he really the Son of God? Let me try and see. Let me push him to the world. Like, he wanted the earthly Messiah, the fiscal kingdom. So let me push him. The people wanted to make him king at one point. Mm-hmm. And people think that it was Jesus that actually incited the people when Jesus had fed the 5,000, the 4,000.
Okay.
So he wanted to push him. If indeed he's a Messiah, let me, and he will not do it himself. Let me betray him and let's see. Maybe he will seize. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So he couldn't believe.
Or did he free himself, right?
He couldn't believe that Jesus would allow himself to be taken. That. So then he said, wow, I've committed something very terrible now. And what is the consequence? What is going to come? And he now felt. So it was not so much as appreciating that he had hurt Jesus, but he was looking at what could be the consequence of this. And then he went to hang himself.
So then my third question would be that, what early rewards, you know, motivate our faith today, and how can we desist from such, you know, things?
Okay, thank you very much. Just a little briefly before we touch on what is the application. You were just opposing the repentance, as it were, of Judas to that of David. And look at David. He was not just asking for the forgiveness, but the cleansing. So that he'll be right again with God.
Mm.
That is what repentance is all about. People say it's a U-turn, a 180 degree. So you're on this course, you turn. Mm. You are sorry for what you've done, and you want to get rid of it and turn in the opposite way to be right with God, as it were.
Okay.
And the true repentance goes to appreciating that you've hurt somebody.
Mm.
You've hurt somebody who so loved you that he gave his very life.
Mm-hmm.
And then you've done this again. So you're hurting a person. So it's not so much about the action or the consequence, about the person that you've hurt. Okay. Incidentally, unfortunately, most of us also follow in the seat of Judas in coming to Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Judas had what was in it for him. That's why he came. Most of us, sometimes you think about Christians going to certain places and you don't understand. Because by their fruits, if genuinely they're going to see Jesus or they want to see Jesus, there are certain places they should run away from.
Mm.
But because you can see everything that this so-called man of God is actually a magician. Because the signs are so clear.
Mm-hmm.
But the people are not, they are not really there to see Jesus. They want answers or they want some solution to their problem.
Mm-hmm.
So however it comes, once the name of Jesus is mentioned, that's enough for them. They do not go in there. So these days, people go for all sorts of solutions to their problems. Mm-hmm. It may be financial.
Okay.
People want jobs. They want money. They want to get married.
They really want to repent from a particular sin.
No. It's all about what is in it for them.
Mm-hmm.
And then people are, maybe there's some spiritual problems.
Mm-hmm.
They are being harassed. So they want answers. So it's not about seeking Jesus. But the thing is that you put him first.
Mm-hmm.
And then all these things would follow, but we're now putting the cart before the horse.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
So, but then we're not talking about the unpardonable sin today. So maybe somebody out there, viewer, may think that, well, I have committed the unpardonable sin and I don't think I can be forgiven. So quickly, in brief, what would you say is an unpardonable sin? And then, let me just take your submission on that first.
Okay, with your permission, I would like us to look at Mark chapter 3. Where Jesus talks about that particular He says that all manner of sins shall be forgiven men. Mm-hmm. That is Mark chapter 3, verse 28.
Okay.
And whatever blasphemy, he even goes on to talk about blasphemy. But then in the next verse, 29, then he talks about blaspheming against the Holy Spirit then becomes the unpardonable sin. Mm. With your permission, I think I would like to read 28 and 29. It says, assuredly I say to you, all sins will be forgiven, the sons of men, and whatever blasphemies they may utter. But then verse 29 says, but he who blasphemes against the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness,
okay,
but is subject to eternal condemnation. All manner of sins, every sin,
will be forgiven.
So even when you blaspheme against the Holy Spirit,
then it will be forgiven.
It will be forgiven. So what is a blasphemy against the Holy Spirit then? Which we said an unpardonable sin. Why did Jesus even say this? Whoever states gives a little clue. He said, because they said he has an unclean spirit. Here they had clear, incontrovertible evidence that this is power. Evil spirits are subject to him. And then they said that even what he was doing, casting out demons, he was rather doing it
with the same evil. That's what Jesus said. A kingdom can divide against itself will not stand.
Absolutely. When you have evidence and you are putting it off, it's so clear, and you are closing your eyes to it, we ought to be very careful. You could be the preacher man, it doesn't matter. Because what happens is that the danger is that it's a spirit that is pleading with you, and then you have the evidence, right? You're pushing it away. It comes a time when you will no more be receptive to the pleading of the spirit. And then if you are no more receptive to the pleading of the spirit, then you cannot be convicted. And then that is almost like your probation is closed.
So it's just like it's the sin that you don't confess. Because God says all sins that we confess, he will forgive.
Yes.
So if you don't confess it and repent from it, genuine repentance.
That's it. Because you've gotten to the point where you don't even see the thing as a sin. So how would you confess? Mm. You confess when you appreciate that you've hurt the person. But you've been pushing that thing away. Mm. So it's more to do with the persistent refusal of the pleading of the Holy Spirit.
Okay.
And then you come to this point where you don't even see the thing as sin, so you even confess. And because you can't confess, you cannot be forgiven. Because again, 1 John 1:9 tells us that he's faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we confess, like you said.
All right. So then my last question to you will be that how are we to convince ourselves, of the Lord's forgiveness if we have truly repented? How can we convince ourselves that? Because sometimes we say that, I think the Lord has forgiven me, all right, but sometimes we tend to go back to the very same issue, and then maybe our guilty conscience seems to haunt us. So how can we convince ourselves that, truly, if we have genuinely repented, God, our Father, has forgiven us?
Just take a look at Calvary.
Okay.
That is God hanging on there, naked, because of you and I.
Mm.
Just suppose that to what he left, King of Kings, King of the universe, creator of the universe, worshipped by myriads of angels, and he left it all for you and I. And you look at Calvary, there's no way you can be ever be in doubt that he will not forgive. So like the text that we said, 1 John 1:9, if we confess, if we truly appreciate that we've hurt him, it is him that we've hurt, and we are sorry for that particular sin, we want to be right again with him. Mm-hmm. Once we come to him, most definitely, he will forgive. He said, he that comes to me, I will in no wise cast out.
He that comes to me, I will in no wise cast out. Well, I thank Mr. Osei Kweku, the Director of Works of the Valley View University, has done justice to this topic of true repentance and false repentance. But let me quickly add that this is the final part of the Time with Jesus segment of expectations. We are saying that Jesus is on his way, and the program is on GTV Live, Your Religion and Culture Channel. My name is Ernest Entribui Siakon, and we are, based on the feedback that we had over the first program on the struggles of prophecy, we are trying to repeat this movie for the last time. So viewers, enjoy it whilst in the comfort of your homes.
Good evening, friends, and welcome to the Last Day of Prophecy series Over the next 7 presentations, we're going to be looking at some of the most important and some of the most fascinating prophecies found in the Bible. My name is John Ross, and I'll be your host for the series. A very warm welcome to those of you here in Charlotte, North Carolina. We are so glad you came out and joined us this evening, and keep coming through the rest of the series. A lot of important information that is yet to come. I'd also like to welcome my friends watching across the country and around the world. This is an extended Bible study. So thank you for taking the time to join us. I think you will learn a lot as we study God's Word together. I'd like to invite Charles to come forward, and we're going to sing Jesus Will Come on Time. The words will be on the screen, and friends, let's stand as we sing together. Thank you, Charles.
Okay, folks, let's lift our voices and signify to Jesus that His Word will be coming true now. All right. Jesus will come on time. Yes, He will come on time. Doubters will talk and scoffers mock, babbling without a rhyme or reason. His promises are true. He will remember you. The clock of prophecy will chime with faith. Of ladder, we will climb with brilliant glory, source of life. Our God will come on time. Yes, Jesus will come on time. Let's get ready to do that one more time. You got it now. Jesus will come on time. Yes, He will come on time. And doubters will talk and scoffers mock, babbling without a rhyme or a reason. His promises are true. He will remember you. The clock of prophecy will chime up Jacob's ladder. We will climb in brilliant glory, source of life. Our God will come on time. Yes, Jesus will come on time. Jesus will come on time. Jesus will come on time. One more time. Jesus will come on.
Amen. Amen. Let's bow our heads for an opening prayer. Dear Father in heaven, we are so grateful to be able to gather together and spend some time in your words studying these very important prophetic truths. And Lord, whenever we open up the Bible, we need the Holy Spirit to come and guide our hearts and our minds. So we invite the Spirit to come and lead us into a clearer and a full understanding of Scripture tonight. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. I'm very happy to introduce our speaker for this series, Pastor Doug Batchelor. He is the president, director, and speaker of Amazing Facts. Amazing Facts is a media ministry, and so we are just delighted to be here in Charlotte. Pastor Doug, if you want to join me on stage, we just came from Northern California not too long ago, and I think we're getting over the jet lag for the most part.
From California or from South Africa?
We were actually in South Africa just prior to this event, so maybe that's more of the jet lag.
There's a little jet lag there. Good evening, friends.
Well, Pastor Doug, we are so excited about this, and we want to give you as much time as needed to do the presentation, so it's all yours.
Thank you, Pastor Ross. And our presentation tonight is dealing with the secret code in prophecy. Now, the Bible is a book filled with stories, but you know, the Bible is also a book filled with numbers. There's even a book in the Bible called Numbers. And certain numbers appear frequently. And I believe after years of studying the Bible that the stories in the Bible give us pictures in salvation, and they also help unlock prophecy. And the numbers, of course, do as well. You know, I remember years ago hearing about the Enigma machine. You've probably heard of that as well. It was a machine that was built by the Germans. I'm struggling with my on button here, pardon me. And this machine is actually built back during World War I. They used it for business. But when World War II broke out, the Nazis found out that it was such an incredibly sophisticated machine with wheels and gears and buttons and wires so that they would transfer a message through this machine, and only those with a code book in the machine at the other end could understand that message. They figured it was an unbreakable code. But what they didn't count on is there was a group of brilliant Polish mathematicians who, working with some British agents, they were able to crack the Enigma code. And that, along with their capturing a code book from a Russian U-boat that they ended up sinking, so the Germans wouldn't know that the code book was captured, they were able to understand the correspondence between the German military for the last half of World War II. The U.S. even built a computer. See, once they got the message, then they had to decipher it very quickly. It was one of the first supercomputers as big as a truck. Now it would fit in your watch. And all that computer did was decipher Enigma messages. The U.S. built that machine for them. So through the combined work of the Allies, they figure they took 2 years off of World War II because they understood the code of that machine. Well, you know, in nature and in the Bible, we see that there are cycles. Even in the book of Ezekiel, chapter 1, it talks about a wheel within a wheel. And you can see these wheels within wheels that are taking place in Bible prophecy. We're going to talk a little bit about some of those unusual cycles in our presentation tonight. Now, first question. We're going to do this in a series of questions. And the first question I'm going to ask, I like using this kind of question-answer teaching method. Did Jesus give us some signs so we could know that they would indicate that his coming was near? I'm not talking about the day and the hour, near. What did he say? You can look in Matthew chapter 24, verse 33. When you see all these things, know that it is near. He lists a group of prophecies and he says, when you see these prophecies being fulfilled, know that my coming is near. He wants us to know. And again, there'll be signs, Jesus said, in the sun and in the moon and in the stars and on the earth, distress of nations, things above, things in humanity, things in nature. There'll be signs that will intensify in frequency and their occurrence, and this will indicate his coming is near. And Jesus said, when you see these things, lift up your heads. There'll be perplexity of nations and the sea and the waves roaring. Now, what are some of the signs? I could stop right here and go into a presentation of about 50 different things that I think are signs that tell us that we are living in what I believe is the last generation. But I'm just going to list a few that really stand out for me. One is found in the book of Daniel, chapter 12, verse 4, where he says, but you, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book until the time of the end. Many will run to and fro, and knowledge is increased. I read a National Geographic article not too long ago that said, this is the time in history when people are traveling more than any other time away from the place of their birth. You just heard Pastor Ross and I allude to, we were on the other side of the planet a couple of weeks ago in South Africa. And Karen and I this year, or within the last year anyway, were in Fiji and New Zealand and just people going around the globe. They never did that back in Christ's day. He never went more than 100 miles from the place of his birth. How many of you knew somebody that grew up and spent their whole life and they never traveled 100 miles? I knew a guy that lived 70 miles from the ocean. At 80 years old, he had never seen the ocean. Someone finally took him, and he was amazed. He said, wow, that's a lot of water. But people will run to and fro, and knowledge will be increased. How many of you have a smartphone? You can access all of the wisdom of the ages now by just talking to it and ask it a question. I've just discovered this feature on my phone. It's been on phones for a long time. And it's amazing. My smartphone makes me feel dumb, actually. But if you had showed something like that to the Apostle Paul, he would have thought you were possessed. So knowledge has increased more in the last 50 years than all of the history of man combined. So that's one of the signs. Here's another one. Jesus said, this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to the nations, and then the end will come. He didn't say it might come. He says, then the end will come. And, you know, even now, this broadcast, through the medium of television. It is bouncing in about half a second off satellites 23,000 miles up in space and ricocheting through the internet all over the world. And this is just one presentation, one ministry, or actually a group of ministries that are preaching the gospel, and there's hundreds. I had the privilege of conducting one of the first public evangelistic programs in mainland China about a year and a half ago, preaching to a group like this, full auditorium, free, 15 presentations. They told me it was the first time that had been allowed in 59 years. And so we've seen it happening. And the DVDs and the internet, the gospel is going everywhere now. Jesus didn't say everybody would believe. He said, but it would go to all the nations, then the end will come. I think we're living in that generation that will see this. Now, this is a part I need to emphasize right at the front end of our study tonight. Next question, can anyone know the exact date of Jesus' return? I'm going to be talking about some signs, but we've got to be careful. Jesus was very clear, but of that day and that hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. No man knows. And if someone starts acting like they know the day and the hour, the year that Jesus is coming, right away you know there's something wrong with their theology. Jesus was very clear, but we can know when it's near. And that's what we're going to be talking about. Jesus said, you know how to tell the weather. I mean, the weathermen can try and predict the weather with some accuracy by satellites, and they have a perspective. And Jesus said, how come you can't see the signs of the times? So the Lord has given us signs of the times, but no man knows the day and the hour of his coming. And I want to make that very clear in this presentation, because I'm going to talk about some of the signs, and we're going to talk about some times, but not dates for the Lord's coming. All right, question number three. What number appears most frequently in prophecy? You knew it. The number seven. And here's just one verse in the Bible in the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 1, verse 20 talks about the mystery of the seven stars, which he saw in my right hand, and the seven golden lampstands, and the seven stars of the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands which he saw are seven churches. It's pretty clear about the number seven. I've just got a small list here in my Bible that I assembled of some of the sevens that you find in Scripture. And you got, of course, 7 days of creation, 7 days before the flood, 7 days Noah and his family stayed in the ark before the rain started. There was seven fat and seven skinny cows in Joseph's dream. 7 years that Jacob worked for Rachel. 7 times Elijah prayed on Mount Carmel. And it goes on and on with all the sevens. Matter of fact, I think there are about 35, some of the sevens that you find in, I've got some signs from sevens in nature here I was going to show you. You know, one of the strongest structures in the world is a bee's honeycomb, which is 6 hexagons circling the internal one, a seventh. The cable that holds up the Golden Gate Bridge is 6 strands with a seventh going through the middle. It's kind of how our week has been designed. A rainbow has 7 colors. When you sing, you got 6 notes, do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. If you sing do twice, then you get 8. There are actually 7 Roman numerals. Now, here's something interesting that comes up later. If you add up the first 6 Roman numerals, you know what it comes to? 666. Of course, the D is 500. So you add up the first 6, it's 666. 7 continents, 7 seas, 7 wonders of the world. Your head has 7 entrances. I don't know what that means, but just some of the things that, you know, you think about. But the number 7 is also in the Bible symbolic of some things. 7's often associated with judgment. 6 things the Lord hates. Yes, 7 are an abomination to them. You've heard about the 7 deadly sins. And again, you can read in Leviticus 26:18. And after all this, if you do not obey me, then I'll punish you 7 times more for your sins. Similar verses found in Leviticus 26:21. And if you walk contrary to me, and if you're not willing to obey me, then it says, I'll bring on you 7 times more plagues according to your sins. judgment. That's kind of frightening. But because it's connected with judgment, seven is also connected with forgiveness. For instance, Peter said, Lord, how often shall I forgive my brother? Matthew 18. Seven times, and Jesus said, 70 times seven. He didn't say not seven times, but 70 times seven. Mary Magdalene, the Bible talks about, who was first at the tomb. It says, he appeared to Mary, out of whom Jesus cast seven devils. Again, forgiveness. When the priest went before the Lord, he took the blood of the sacrifice and he sprinkled it seven times before the Lord. And so seven, connected with forgiveness. You may remember the story in 2 Kings chapter 5 about Naaman, the general, who was a leper. He was told to wash in the Jordan. Jordan is a symbol of where Jesus was baptized, death, burial, resurrection, baptism, seven times, and he was cleansed from his leprosy. Miriam spent 7 days outside of the tabernacle with her leprosy, and then she was healed. And so seven is sometimes like a cycle of time that talks about a judgment. You can also find where it says, a righteous man may fall seven times, but rise again. But the wicked will fall by calamity. God will forgive. Righteous man, you fall. Mary Magdalene, seven devils cast out. She was the first one Jesus appeared to after he rose from the dead. So how does an eternal God view time? Now we're talking about numbers in time. How does an eternal God view time? You and I, we live maybe 70, which is 70 years. That's an average the Bible gives us. Not too far from the average today. Depends on what country you're in and your lifestyle. But the Bible tells us in 2 Peter 3:8, but beloved, do not forget this one thing, that with the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years like a day. If you live forever, then a millennium is like a day for you. It's nothing. And Peter's actually quoting where Solomon says in Proverbs chapter, that's an incorrect scripture there, I think. It's in Proverbs maybe 8:10, a day in your courts, it's actually Psalms 84:10. For a day in your courts is better than 1,000. And King David said something similar in Psalm 91. Now, I don't know if you've ever heard before of the theory of what they call the millennial week. The millennial week. You ever heard of that before? Now, you know what a millennium is. Millennium is a Latin composite of two words. Milli means thousand. Annum means years. There is a chapter in Revelation 20 that talks about 1,000 years where the saved live and reign with the Lord. Well, if you add up the dates in the Bible, you know, the Bible is full of chronology. There in Genesis chapter 5, it begins with a chronology that leads to Abraham. The book of Matthew, the New Testament, opens with the chronology of Jesus Christ. And the dates are given in a number of these chronologies, how long people lived. So with a little bit of a calculator and some educated guesses, you can figure out that the world is just about 6,000 years old now. Now, we don't know exactly how old. There's a few ambiguities around the time of Noah. It says Noah had three boys, but it doesn't tell when he had which one, unless they were triplets, which I don't think. And so there's a few vague spots, so we're not exactly sure. I want to make that very clear. But one thing we are pretty sure of is that the world is about 6,000 years old biblically. Even if, you know, for those of you that believe in these long ages of creation, you can't argue with the facts of what the Bible says. And what I'm talking to you about is what the Bible says. This is a Bible seminar. So you look at Adam was created approximately 4,000 years before Christ. Notice I didn't say he was born. He was created. And so you've got about 2,000 years. Bishop Usher's chronology was 4,004 B.C. You got 2,000 years from Adam to Abraham. They call that the age of the patriarchs. And about 2,004 B.C., Abraham was born. Again, this is just approximate. Then you got 2,000 years from Abraham to Jesus. That's kind of interesting. You realize Jesus was not born in the year zero. After they set up this AD-BC dating method, and it was well entrenched, they realized they were off a few years because King Herod the Great died 2 BC. Well, we know he was alive when the babies in Bethlehem were slaughtered, and we've figured out Jesus was baptized the 27th year about 27 AD. It says on his 30th birthday. All you got to do is count back and realize, oh, if he was baptized 27 AD and it was his 30th birthday, he was actually born in the BC age. Christ was born about 4 BC. So you got 2,000 years from Adam to Abraham, 2,000 years from Abraham to Jesus, and where are we today? About 2,000 years after Christ. You know where we're living right now? We're living in this spot somewhere between the birth and the death of Jesus. We're past the time of 2,000 years from when he was born, but we're before the time of when he began his ministry and when he died. It's a very interesting time in history. Now, some people thought Jesus is coming 2,000 years after his birth. I actually am on record in 1999 telling people I don't think that's true. You know why? Because everybody thought so. You remember the big fury in 1999? Any of you alive back then? Any of you, if you remember Y2K and the world was going to end and all the planes were going to fall out of the sky? And I said, no, I don't think Jesus is coming December 31, 1999. Really? Why not? Because all of you think so. And Jesus said, in such an hour, you think not the Son of Man is coming. Now the church has pretty much gone to sleep. It could be any time. Some people are then setting dates and saying, well, Jesus is going to come 2,000 years, not from his birth, but from his ministry, his baptism, his anointing. Others say, no, it's 2,000 years from his death. Don't even go there, friends. I'll tell you why. It could be sooner than you think. Because Jesus said, except those days be shortened, no flesh would be saved. It could be later than you think. Because the Lord is long-suffering to us. We're not willing that any should perish. He's waiting till the last minute to save as many as he can. So we've got to be very careful to start trying to pinpoint dates. And some of you, if you knew the date, it'd be like filing your taxes. You'd wait till the last minute to get ready. So the Lord wants you to just be ready. And by the way, he could come for you tomorrow. Because if you die, your next conscious thought is the coming of the Lord. Ready or not, the Bible says, prepare to meet thy God. And everybody is going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ. And so we shouldn't be playing with eternities, thinking that we're supposed to postpone our salvation or our commitment to God until we can pick the day when he's coming. You're thinking like that, there's something wrong with your relationship. It's like saying you want to wait till the last minute to enjoy as much sin as you can, and then just before Jesus comes, you'll repent and get ready. We all know folks who think that way. You know, someone reminded me one time, there are a couple of examples of what they call deathbed conversions in the Bible, like the thief on the cross, so that nobody needs to lose hope. But there's only one or two, so nobody dare presume. And we need to be ready if you're a believer. So let's not set dates. But it's interesting, 2,000 years Adam to Abraham, the age of the patriarchs, 2,000 years from Abraham to Jesus, the age of the Jews, 2,000 years from Jesus, we believe, approximately somewhere, to his second coming. And then we live and reign with Christ like a 1,000-year Sabbath. Now, look at some of the patterns in the Bible that talk about this. And I just told you about that one. And then you have there in Revelation chapter 20, they live and reign with Christ for a millennium, a 1,000-year period of time. Some of you remember when God said to Adam and Eve, in the day that you eat of it, you will surely die. He told Adam and Eve, if you sin, in the day. Now, the day that Adam and Eve ate the fruit, did they drop dead?
No.
Well, spiritually, I think all of us would agree something went wrong. They died inside. But they didn't die physically. But if a day with the Lord is like 1,000 years and 1,000 years is a day, the Bible says Adam lived 930 years and he died. And who is the oldest man that ever lived? That's a trick question. Methuselah is the oldest man who ever died. The father of Methuselah, what was his name? Enoch. He didn't die. So Enoch is technically the oldest man who ever lived. Methuselah is the oldest man who ever died. And how long did he live? 969 years. Was there any man that lived more than 1,000 years? In the day that you eat thereof, a day with the Lord is like 1,000 years, you will die. And God made Adam and Eve to live forever. So when God said, you're going to die in the first 1,000 years, they were heartbroken. You'd think, man, if I could live 500 years, that'd really be something. But Adam and Eve were supposed to live forever. So when they were told, you're going to die in the first millennium, it was a day for them. Question number five. Did Jesus ever tell the apostles they would witness the second coming or his coming in glory? The answer is yes. If you look in Matthew chapter 16, verse 28, you'll find this in Mark chapter 9 as well. It says, "Assuredly I say to you, there are some of you standing here who will not taste of death till they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." They were going to get a miniature picture of the second coming. After Jesus makes this cryptic statement, it says after 6 days. Why did he make the statement? And in the book of Matthew, in the book of Mark, it says 6 days later something happened. It's very clear after he makes the statement, he makes a statement in Luke too. The next thing that happens is this experience. What happens? After 6 days, he took Peter, James, and John, his brother, led them up on a high mountain by themselves. His face was shining like the sun. His clothes became as white as the light. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them and were talking with him. This was like a miniature picture of the second coming. He said, "You're not going to die until you see the Son of Man coming in power." It says that Christ is surrounded by clouds of glory. Will he come in the clouds? Moses is there because Moses is someone who died, but God resurrected him. Elijah's there because Elijah's somebody who did not die, but he was caught up to meet the Lord in the air. There's going to be two kinds of people when Jesus comes. The dead in Christ rise. Those who are alive and remain are caught up. These two individuals represented the two classes of people. And God the Father speaks. He says, "This is my beloved Son. Hear him." Christ said, "I'm coming in the glory of the Father." This was a miniature picture of the second coming. And even more than that, what they call the Mount of Transfiguration is the ultimate endorsement. Because here you've got Moses who represents the law, Elijah who represents the prophets. They're both pointing to Jesus and saying, "He is the one. He is the Messiah." This is, and God the Father says, "This is my Son." So you got the mouth of two or three witnesses saying Jesus is the Messiah. And they're talking to Peter, James, and John. Now, if you're a Jew, what could be the best testimony you could get? If you said, "Well, Moses says that he's the Messiah and Elijah says he's the Messiah," could you get a better endorsement than that? You know, we're in a political season right now, the time of this recording. Kind of nauseating, isn't it? And everybody's trying to get endorsements. They try to get the most powerful and important people to endorse them. Nobody more powerful than Moses and Elijah. You know how the Old Testament ends? Malachi chapter 4. "Remember the law of Moses. Behold, I send you Elijah." The law and the prophets is another way of saying the word of God. Moses represents the law, Elijah the prophets. That's the New and the Old Testaments. It's the law and the prophets. The New Testament's even part of the prophets. The testimony of the word is that Jesus is the Messiah. But this was a miniature picture of the second coming. So what are some of the other Bible stories, question six, that reference this cycle of seven? They got quite a few. Now, I hope you're taking notes. You will be, some of you maybe got a flyer that has some of these in there. But, for example, how long was Moses on Mount Sinai getting the Ten Commandments? 40 days and 40 nights. But you remember there was another time period before he went up. "Now the glory of the Lord rested on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it for how long? 6 days. And on the seventh day, the Lord called to Moses out of the cloud, and Moses went up, and he spent 40 days on the mountain." You notice it says, Jesus said, "You're going to see a miniature of the second coming." After 6 days, he took them up a mountain. And now Moses goes up a mountain after 6 days. And a day with the Lord is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years like a day. I think, I'm suspicious, that after 6 days we're going up. That after 6 millennia, I don't know when that's going to be, but I think the Lord does things in patterns in the Bible, and he's going to stick to that. Another law they had, just some of the other stories. If you buy a Hebrew servant, Exodus chapter 21, 2, he will serve 6 years, and in the seventh year, he'll go free. Now, is Jesus going to set the captives free when he comes? So 6 years, the people in the world have been enslaved to the devil. He's a hard taskmaster. But the Lord's going to come and he's going to set the captives free. And those who've trusted in Christ will be liberated at that time. Jericho. You know, when the children of Israel, the first battle to take the promised land was a city called Jericho. How many times did they march around the city of Jericho? 13 times. Everyone gets that wrong. You all remember how many times They marched around the city the last day. But it says they marched around the city once for 6 days. Then on the seventh day, they marched around the city seven times. That's a total of 13. How many were at the Last Supper? 13. What does that mean? I don't know, but I just think I always just think about these numbers. Just stir up your pure minds. You might give me your ideas. Anyway, but notice 6 days of marching around the city. Then the seventh day, they took the promised land. Are God's people going to perhaps get to see the promised land when we enter the seventh day? Another story. By the way, I wish I had 2 hours. By the way, you know how you say Joshua in Hebrew, I mean in Greek? Jesus. And the way you say Jesus in Hebrew, it's Yeshua, Joshua, same name. Joshua comes to Jericho and they blow seven trumpets. Does Revelation talk about seven trumpets? And they shout. Is there a shout when Jesus comes? The Lord will descend from heaven with a shout, the voice of the archangel, the trump of God. The dead will rise, and everybody died in that city of destruction except Rahab, because she had a red token in her window, the blood of Christ. Everyone in the house with her was saved. Everyone in Christ and in the church of Christ, meaning his body, will be saved when he comes. These stories are giving us an insight into the themes of the second coming. It came to pass on the seventh day, they marched around the city seven times, and in the same manner, on that day, they marched around the city seven times. They blew the trumpets, the wall fell, and they took the promised land. How about the story of King Joash? Now, this is a story some of you may not know. I'm teaching as though some of you have some Bible background. King Joash, you find this in 2 Kings chapter 11, was one of the young sons of David. He was 1 year old when his father died in battle. His wicked grandmother, her name was Athaliah. When Athaliah, the son of Ahaziah, saw, the mother of Ahaziah, saw that her son was dead, she arose and she destroyed all of the royal heirs, the royal seed. But Jehoshaphat took Joash and hid him and his nurse in the bedroom from Athaliah so that he was not killed. And he was hidden with her in the house of the Lord for how long? 6 years, while Athaliah reigned over the land. He was 1 year old. She rules over the land for 6 years. Tyranny. By the way, Athaliah is the daughter of Jezebel. Right away, you know she's bad. She is synonymous. Jezebel was called a harlot by the other prophets. She is the daughter of a harlot. In Revelation 17, it talks about Babylon, mother of harlots. And they worship pagan gods with harlotry back in those days. But the son of David, what is Jesus called sometimes? What did they say to David, Jesus when he came down the Mount of Transfiguration? Hosanna to the Son of David. Son of David, have mercy on me. Joash, the son of David, the only survivor of David's line, is hidden in the house of the Lord. Where's Jesus right now? He's in the heavenly temple pleading. He's our high priest, Hebrews said, pleading his blood before the Father. We come boldly before the Father through Christ. But the Bible tells us after 6 years, you know what happened? The high priest Jehoiada brought Joash out of the temple. Christ is going to leave that holy place and he's going to come back. They blew the trumpets. And you know what it says? It's very interesting. They did it as the Sabbath began, when everything would be quiet in the city and people were going to be getting ready, just as the Sabbath began. That's at the end of the week, right? They all came together. He told the soldiers, blow the trumpet, shout, I'm going to bring the son of David out. We'll put the crown on his head. He received the kingdom. Athaliah and all that followed her were slain. This is what's going to happen when Jesus comes. There'll be two groups, those that are loyal to the son of David and those that are not. And the same thing that happened in that story. The people rejoiced. The wicked were slain. For 6 years, she ruled over the land. Did God give his people a law about farming connected with the Sabbath? Question number 8. Yeah, you know this. 6 years you will sow your land and gather in its produce. But the what? The seventh it will rest. Now they didn't listen to this law because they were trying to make too much money. God told them, rest your land, let the poor eat of it. Just leave it desolate. Let it grow volunteer. But they wouldn't do it. So God carried him off to Babylon for 70 years. He said, if you're not going to let the land keep Sabbath, I'm going to give the land an enforced Sabbath. While you're in Babylon, here's the verse that talks about that. As long as she, the land, lay desolate, she kept Sabbath to fulfill 70 years. When Jesus comes next, when the millennium begins, what direction do we go? The Lord will come down. We'll be caught up to meet him in the air. And this world is going to be in a desolate condition during that 1,000 years while we live and reign with Christ in glory. What are some of the other patterns of seven in Scripture? We've got a lot, friends. Question number 9. Enoch, you can read in the book of Jude. Enoch is the seventh from Adam. He prophesied about these men saying, "Behold, the Lord comes with 10,000 of his saints." Now, we just talked about Enoch, the father of Methuselah. What direction did Enoch go? He went up. What generation was he? He was the seventh. So if you count from Adam, Seth, Enos, you make your way up to Enoch, you got six before him, the seventh goes up. And the seventh, Jude says, talks about the Lord is coming. Very interesting. I don't know, maybe I'm seeing stuff that isn't really there. But to me, I just see a pattern. You can read in Job, "In six troubles he will deliver you. Yes, in seven no evil will touch you." Why does no evil touch us in seven? Because we're caught up. Not going to touch us then. Jacob, how long did he work for Rachel? It didn't seem like anything to him because he loved her. By the way, if you love the Lord, working for the Lord is no problem if you love him. People that complain about the burdens of being a believer, you just got to fall in love with the Lord. And if Jesus said, "If you love me, keep my commandments." And after 7 years, first his father-in-law tried to trick him. So he had to have a honeymoon with Leah, who he didn't anticipate. But then he said, "I'll also fulfill her week. And then I'll also give you Rachel. But you got to work another 7 years." But there was a wedding after 7 years. According to the Bible, after the millennium, the New Jerusalem, Revelation 21, comes down adorned like a what? Like a bride. And you get the wedding supper of the Lamb. Another story in the Bible that kind of bears out this big picture of salvation. You remember there was a famine in the land, and Elijah prayed for rain. And he sent his servant to the ocean. He said, "Any rain yet?" He said, "It hasn't rained for 3.5 years. There's nothing." He prayed again. He prayed again. He prayed again. Came to pass. After 6 times, the servant came back and said, "Nothing, nothing, nothing." 7th time he prayed. He said, "You know, there's a cloud coming up out of the sea." And that cloud grew and it filled the sky and it poured and there was a storm. And by the way, there's going to be a storm, friends, in the future, just before Jesus comes. Christ said there's going to be a time of trouble such as there never has been since there was a nation, even under that same time. You've heard of the tribulation? This is why Jesus said, "He that endures to the end will be saved." We've got to have a faith now where we believe his word and we love the Lord. Amen? There was a cloud, small like a man's hand, rising up out of the sea. Question number 10. Did Jesus foretell there might be an appearance of delay connected with his return? All right, now, I just gave you a number of, and I didn't give them all because they're time constraints. I just gave you a number of examples in the Bible of these cycles that you see. You know, one thing I didn't mention. I got this here in my notes. I told you got kind of wheels within the wheels in the Bible. And, for example, in the Bible, there is a week of days. We got a 7-day week. At the end, you got the Sabbath. You got a week of weeks in the Bible. After Passover, you go 7 weeks, a week of weeks, and then you'd had Pentecost. You've heard of that before. That's why it was 50 days or 49 days, and the 50th was called Pentecost. You had a week of months in the Bible. After Passover, they waited 7 months, and they had their Feast of Trumpets. You had a week of years. Every 7 years, you'd rest the land, and you'd let the captive go free, if you had a Hebrew slave. You had a week of decades, you might say. They would count 7 sets of 7 years, and the 49th year, you had a jubilee on the 50th. Amazing Facts is just celebrating our 50th anniversary as a ministry, and so it's kind of our jubilee. And then you had 7 decades. 70 weeks is in Daniel chapter 9, comes up to 490 years. Jesus talks about forgiving 70 times 7. So since you've got 7 days and weeks and months and years and decades and centuries, why wouldn't you have 7 millenniums? And that's what I'm saying. I think it's all a package biblically and that it all fits together. All right, back to question 10. What were some of the other examples in the Bible that Jesus gave us to tell us don't be disconcerted if people, even believers, start to think maybe he's late? I mean, here, 6,000 years have gone by. It's been 2,000 years since Christ was born. How come he hasn't come back yet? Don't forget, when Jesus came the first time, was the church ready for his first coming? Did his own people with the Bible grow tired of waiting for the Messiah? Why would we think the devil's going to be any different? It's going to be the same way the second coming as it was the first. And they weren't reading the Bible. There was a few wise men in the east, a couple of people in the temple, Anna and Simeon, some shepherds in the field, but most people were not ready for the first coming. The devil hasn't changed. So what are some examples Jesus gave us so we can know that he told us prepare for a time of delay that will test your faith, or at least the appearance of delay? After Jesus gives the signs in Matthew 24, talking about the second coming, he tells the disciples, if that evil servant says in his heart, my Lord is delaying his coming, and he begins to eat and drink with the drunken. Why would he mention, if that servant says, my Lord delays? You know, it sounds like Christ is quoting what happened when the children of Israel got tired of waiting for Moses to come back. Moses went up the mountain to get the Ten Commandments, but he was, you know, over 80 years old. And he went up there and there's thunder and smoke coming out of the mountain, and the mountain shaking. And after a few weeks, you'd start to worry, you know, an old guy up there, he could have tripped, he's by himself. He's probably not coming back. After 3 weeks, 4 weeks, after 40 days, they say, oh, this is it. He's not coming back. We can't go up the mountain. We're forbidden. We got to get someone else. It says, while Moses delayed, when the people saw that Moses delayed coming down the mountain, they were being tested. What did they do? Many of them failed the test. They made a golden calf. They compromised their worship. Could the church be faced with the same kind of test today? We're in a time of waiting right now when our faith should be growing stronger, and some are compromising, trying to be like the world. Another example in the Bible. You've heard of Samuel the prophet. Samuel anointed Saul to be king, and he said, you're going to have an epic battle with the Philistines. Don't go into battle till I offer sacrifice for you. Samuel was the prophet. He was the priest. He was the judge of Israel. Well, he said, notice what he says. You shall go down before me to Gilgal, and surely I will come. Did Jesus tell you that I will come again? Does he lie? Surely I will come down to you to offer burnt offering and sacrifices of peace offerings. 7 days you'll wait till I come. Wait till I come to you. Very clear instructions. But then the Bible says, Saul, the Philistines were gathering. His men were getting afraid. Many were deserting. 6 days went by. Samuel was not even there. I think I made him a little nervous tonight before the program because there's a lot of preparation and recording one of these things. I had to go back to the hotel room and put on my suit. And I had a beard before the program. You folks saw me today, I had a beard. Karen said, that beard's got to go. So I had to shave. And you know, we weren't that far from starting. I think the crew started getting a little nervous. They thought, where's Doug? thank you, dear. You look nice, too. Oh, by the way, that's my wife, Karen. She's up front. Wave your hand, dear. I didn't introduce her. I'm sorry. She had headphones on a minute ago. I didn't think you wanted her. She looked like she's feeding me information or something. You ever hear about these pastors that their wives, they got earpieces and the wives are telling them what to do? No, really, it's happened. No, she doesn't. She's not telling me. Anyway, so the army of the Philistines was gathering. The people were afraid. And the Bible says he waited 7 days, but Samuel didn't come. And Saul finally said, look, we've got to offer sacrifice. When the seventh day came, he was being tested. He did something that he was forbidden to do. The king was not the priest. He was not supposed to offer the sacrifice. And he went and he did it because the other nations did it. So he thought, it doesn't matter if I do it. He offered sacrifice, and as soon as he was done, guess what happened? Samuel came. Same thing that happened. As soon as they made the golden calf, Moses came. There's going to be a big test in the last days of God's people. That's why Jesus said, many will come to me in that day saying, Lord, Lord. He'll say, I don't know you. Depart from me, you who work iniquity. They lost patience waiting. Time of testing. Why do you think Jesus said in Matthew 25? Matthew 24, signs of the second coming. Matthew 25, while the bridegroom delayed. Who's the bridegroom in that parable? He's a symbol for Jesus. Do we all agree? Did Christ, is he trying to tell us something? That there was a period of testing for those. There's 10 virgins, 5 wise, 5 foolish, right? You know the parable? There's a time of testing. Half of them failed the test because they thought, well, he's not coming back. You can look in John chapter 11 when Jesus resurrects Lazarus. Martha and Mary sent a message to Jesus when he was up in Galilee saying, come quick, your friend Lazarus is sick. And Jesus dilly-dallied. It doesn't use those words in the Bible, but it seems like he waited. Finally, by the time he got there, he was not only dead, he'd been dead 4 days. And Martha and Mary, who loved Jesus, they said, Lord, what's up? You healed so many people. He was your friend. You stayed with us. We told you he was sick. Why were you late? It's too late now. He said, no, I'm not late. You think I'm late, but I'm going to do something now that you didn't anticipate. And though you've been sad, you're going to rejoice. He resurrected Lazarus. But it looked like he was late. The Lord sometimes tests our faith. Will Jesus actually be late for his return? What do you think? Let's read some prophecies on this. It says in Habakkuk. Can you say that book? Habakkuk. The vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it will speak and not lie. Notice. It says, though it tarries, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. In other words, he says, though it tarries, but it will not tarry. Though it appears. And many of the world are saying, I guess the Lord's not coming back. You can read here in Hebrews 10:37, for yet a little while, and he who is coming will come and will not tarry, and the just will live by faith. Friends, is your faith hanging on? Jesus said, I'm coming again. This ought to be the great hope, the blessed hope of believers that will mobilize us. And how would you live if you thought the Lord was coming in a week? We ought to be living that way every day. He said, I will come again, and he will reward everybody. You can read in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 37. If anyone draws back, my soul has no pleasure in him. That's the rest of that verse. Here's one from 2 Peter 3, verse 3 and 4. Knowing this first, that scoffers will come in the last days. That's in the words of our song. Mockers and scoffers. Walking according to their own lusts, saying, where is the promise of his coming? For ever since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation until now. What is Peter talking about? Scoffers in the world? There've always been scoffers in the world. Maybe he's talking about scoffers in the church, in the last days, walking after their own lusts and not walking godly lives, saying, oh, he's never going to come. Yeah, we've heard it. Jesus is coming. Jesus is coming. You preachers have been saying that for years. That's right. One of these days we're going to be right. He is going to come. He told us to let people know. How does the Bible end? Even so, come, Lord Jesus. We can't lose faith in that, friends. It says, Peter says, but the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with a great noise, and the elements will melt with fervent heat, and the earth also and the things that are in it will be burned up. He's going to come. Romans chapter 13, verse 11. And knowing the time, that now it is high time to wake out of sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than when we first believed. What were those? How many of the 10 virgins were wise? How many of them were foolish? How many were sleeping? I wonder if the Lord's telling us something about the condition before the bridegroom comes. We need to wake up. The Bible says the night is far spent. The day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. Friends, I believe we're living in the most exciting time in the earth's history. I believe the Lord has told us in his word, in through the signs of the times, through the stories of the Bible, through the cycles that we see in prophecy, and we'll be sharing a lot more. You need to stick with this program because we're going to be sharing things that you've maybe never heard before, but I promise you it'll be from the word of God. And it's all going to tell you that Christ is coming soon. What's happening behind the scenes in prophecy right now, much of the world is confused about, and how we can be ready. The Lord has not forgotten us. He is going to come again. I remember back in 1995 when all this unfolded during the Bosnian War, one of our fighter pilots, Captain Scott O'Grady, was flying over war-torn Bosnia when his F-16 with a SAM missile tore through his aircraft. And as he pummeled towards the ground, he pulled the ejection lever and he exploded out of what was left of the cockpit, burned his face, injured his eye a little bit, and he parachuted down. And they saw, the enemy on the ground saw that they hit him. They saw him parachute down. They couldn't get to the spot quick enough. And he dropped his chute and went and hid like a scared animal in the brush in the woods. And for 6 days, he was trying to evade the enemy in strange territory. And he was hiding under bushes. Sometimes he saw the boots going just right near him of the enemy looking for him. They knew if they could get that American pilot, it would be quite a trophy. He had a radio and he kept calling for help. He saw the battery was slowly fading on his radio and he wondered if anybody was hearing him. And he said the only thing that sustained him during that time was his love for God, his love for his family, and his love for his country. For 6 days, Captain O'Grady hid. Drank dirty water and he ate bugs and did all he could to survive, kept calling for help. And finally, he heard somebody call back on his radio. They were afraid to call him for fear that others would pick up the transmission. And he was given some instructions. And after 6 days, there was a clearing. He set off a flare and a helicopter descended with 20 Marines jumping out to create a perimeter. He ran to that chopper and jumped in as fast as he could. And the whole thing took 7 minutes. And he got back. And you know, it was amazing. Whenever I hear this story, I know I'm getting old and emotional or something. Just, it was amazing to me that while he was going through that ordeal, he wondered, has my country forgotten about me? Is anybody doing anything for me? Are they going to come back? Maybe I'm just one soldier and they don't care. And if he could only know what was going on behind the scenes, the whole United States military, plus the military of allies, had been mobilized to save one soldier. Now, if faulty man can do that for their fellow man, will God forget about us? Is he going to come again?
Yes.
Friends, you can count on it. And I think that the time is coming near. It's not an accident that you're here. Whether you're here in person in Charlotte or one of our locations around the country, I believe the Lord has brought you to these meetings. And there's others he may want you to invite because we don't have much time left. I think the Lord is coming soon. He wants you to be ready. And once you are ready, he wants you to help get other people ready. Because friends, can you tell me what is more important than eternal life? Jesus gave his life. He died that you might be redeemed from this enemy territory. He's going to come again. We'll be caught up to meet him in the air. And he's going to take us back to those mansions that he's prepared. That's why he said, don't be troubled. You can have peace. There's room for you in my Father's house. Do you believe that, friends? Now, I don't know what's going on in your background. I believe you're watching or you're here by divine appointment. The Lord wants you to be ready. We've just kind of given you a big sweeping picture of the scriptures tonight to illustrate that Jesus is coming soon. Do you believe it?
Yes.
Can I pray for you?
Yes.
Father in heaven, I just want to pray that your presence will be with each person, those that are here in Charlotte, those who may be watching all over the world, and that the Holy Spirit will speak to their hearts right now. They'll know that there is a plan, that you have not forgotten, that you are not